Boxing live here. DJ Boxing live here.
One of Bert Sugar's contenders was no choir boy himself. Harry Greb, the Pittsburgh windmill, had a 294-bout career between 1913 and 1926, losing just 8 times. His style was described by one writer as the manly art of modified murder, and his opponents were often more concerned with avoiding his thumbs and his head than his fists. He fought some of the greatest battlers in ring history in the 3-weight divisions up to heavyweight, including Tommy Loughran, Tiger Flowers, Battling Levinsky, and Gunboat Smith. His abuse of his opponents was matched only by the abuse of his own body, and his career in the ring was mirrored by a string of unofficial fights around the New York speakeasies.
I talked to people who either saw him or fought him, and one of his biggest fans was named Billy Kahn, because he was out of Pittsburgh, yes. And Billy was out of Pittsburgh. Yes. Billy swore this was the greatest thing that ever walked in the ring, and remember, he had seen Armstrong, and he had seen,
yes,
Robinson.
In 1922, Greb inflicted one of the worst beatings in ring history on Gene Tunney, here seen fighting Jack Dempsey. Greb was an incredible 32 pounds lighter than his opponent. It would prove to be the only defeat of Tunney's career. In 1926, Tunney carried Greb's coffin. He died following a routine operation, age 32. It was only then that doctors discovered the true measure of his courage. Harry Greb had fought much of his career completely blind in one eye.
Greb was a great, great fighter who never had a problem with he didn't care who he fought. He'd fight anybody, and he never barred a black fighter. Mm. And he was the sort of guy who would have fought Jack Dempsey. He wanted to fight Jack Dempsey, the heavyweight champion, who was pretty much feared at the time. Greb didn't fear him. He'd have fought him. He busted him up in sparring, and he didn't care. And so by then, to be fair to Greb's reputation, now he was struggling. He was almost blind, and he was on his last, stretch of his career. And Flowers got him at the right time, but they had fought before in a no decision non-title fight, and reports are conflicting. There are some people thought Greb had won it, there were others who thought Flowers won it, but difficult to tell, and enough thought Flowers won it to make a case for him winning the return for the championship when it did come. And Flowers fought out of his skin, didn't stop throwing punches, kept doing what he does. The reports suggest he was just as unorthodox and unpredictable as Greb was, without the fouls. Greb was a legend for taking the law into his own hands. He saw referees as interfering policemen and didn't appreciate their presence in the ring at all, so he liked to do what he wanted. And Flowers would match him if he was fouled. He wouldn't put up with it. But at one point, he stood back and said, is alleged to have said, Mr. Greb, I don't really mind you fouling me all night long, but please don't take the Lord's name in vain. Greb stopped swearing from that moment on. He said, I just burst out laughing and I couldn't swear. What was the point? And fouling, what's the point in that? Because the guy was with me all the way. So it was a hard, hard 15-round fight. And maybe as a reaction to the McTeague decision, Flowers got the verdict. It was very, very close, and he got a split decision, and he won the middleweight championship, and of course...
The best fighter out there was a middleweight, the middleweight champion, Stanley Ketchel, the Michigan Assassin. And there was never quite an assurance that he was human in the ring.
He was a brutal middleweight. He's kind of a guy that you have to kill before you could knock him out.
On the 16th of October, 1909, America put its money on little Stanley Ketchel, though with little optimism.
First time against Stanley Ketchel, Colma, California, 16th of October, 1909.
Here we go into round one. Johnson, much the larger man. Stanley Ketchel is known both as the Michigan Marvel and the Michigan Assassin. He's a great two-fisted puncher. He's famous for his left shift, in which he moves to his left but comes in fast with a right lead, followed by a left hook, a tricky combination. Today is the great moment in Stan Ketchel's life. If he wins, he'll be the first fighter in all history to hold both middleweight and heavyweight titles at the same time. The end of round 10. Ketchel's badly cut up and hurt, but Johnson's not even breathing hard. In the 11th round, Johnson smashes Ketchel all over the ring. Now round 12, Colma, California, October 16th, 1909. Johnson is down. It was a terrific right to the jaw. The referee's count seems fast. Johnson's up at 8. He's mad. Ketchel's excited, comes in wide open, takes a right square on the jaw. They're both down. Johnson gets up and the referee counts over Ketchel. Stanley Ketchel, the Michigan Assassin, is out cold. Jack Johnson retains his heavyweight championship of the world.
Ketchel leaps in with a swinging right, catching Johnson behind the ear, and down goes Johnson. And he puts out his arm and sort of steadies himself, but he does go down. I mean, he's visible. Pops right back up, and as Ketchel runs in for the finishing touch, throws one deep dish. Uppercut. And Ketchel goes out. Sort of lying there like crucifixion on the canvas. While Johnson leans against the ropes and picks four of his teeth out of his glove.
How you doing, fight fans? EJ Boxing Live here. So, to the conclusion of what happened with Stanley Ketchel. Stanley Ketchel was cheating on a man's wife, and the husband caught him. And shot him in his back while he was having breakfast, so he didn't see it coming. And that's how Stanley Ketchel ended his days. It's a shame. He died at like 25. He's quite young as well, and he done so much already. After beating Philadelphia Jack O'Brien to catch the middleweight belt. And you know, the thing is, over all these years, you think about it, no one's ever thought about having a matchup between Stanley Ketchel, the Michigan Assassin, and Harry Greb, the Pittsburgh Windmill. No one's ever thought of it. So I was, in my mind, I was thinking to myself, if these two would ever have met, what kind of fight it would be. And as you just heard there, Stanley Ketchel's the type of guy that you'd have to kill him in the ring. And Harry Greb, type of guy, he's brutalized you. As he said, he don't like the referees interfering. He'll brutalize you into submission. And obviously, he only had one eye. So let's say they were both in their prime. Obviously, Stanley Ketchel was in his prime when he died, even though he lost to Jack Johnson. And this shows you how good both of them are. Both of them challenged, fought heavyweights. Harry Greb fought Gene Tunney and beat up Gene Tunney. Beat up Johnny. He's the only person to ever lose, the only person to actually beat Jim Tunney, and also beat up Jack Dempsey in sparring, beat him up pretty badly in sparring, and he wanted to fight him, and that fight never happened. And also with Ketchel, obviously you see him challenge against Jack Johnson, and to be fair, as a middleweight, to drop Jack Johnson, that's quite impressive. He was getting brutalized in that fight pretty badly, but he actually dropped Jack Johnson in that fight, so you know he's got some heavy hands. And if they was to ever fight, I'd think favor Ketchel maybe with the power, but for the work rate and just the work rate and speed, I'd have to go with the windmill. But the thing is, them two would have put on a fight. I think it would be one of them fights. You'd have to try and tear them apart, man. They'd properly get stuck in. In fact, the middleweight fight of the century. Absolutely, these two. The Michigan Assassin versus the Pittsburgh Windmill. The way he just keeps throwing punches and you have to try and fend him off. Usually brutalizes. I mean, to beat Gene Tunney, who's a very master boxer, he must have put X amount of pressure on Gene Tunney to break him down, and Dempsey. They couldn't probably get his hand speed and power power. Yeah, just breaking you down with his power. And Michigan Assassin, he just brutalized you. Just kept coming forward and keep throwing big bombs on you and stuff like that. Eventually, he usually gets his way. But obviously, with Jack Dempsey, he didn't get his way. But if you really think about it, like, I don't know how they would have fought against Jack Johnson. I don't know how Stanley Ketcher would have fared against Jack Dempsey or Gene Tunney either. Well, we never know. But it's good things to think about. So the Pittsburgh Wing Will, Harry Greb versus Stanley Ketcher, the Michigan Assassin. How do you guys think the fight would have fared? It'd be interesting to think about, to see if there was ever going to fight. Obviously, it would have been a couple of years. I think maybe they would have met somewhere. I think when Stanley Ketcher, maybe in his 30s, I'm not too sure, but because it was at 1909 around them times there. Ketcher, I think Greb came back. I think Greb was in his 20, in the 20s, so I'm not too sure how they would have met. Maybe it would have been the ending of Stanley Ketchell's reign, whatever, but absolutely would have been an epic match. Like I said, middleweight or fight of any century, boy, any war. So leave your comments in the comment section. Tell me how you think the fight would have been. I predict, my prediction of who would win, I'll go with most people just go with Harry Greb, innit? Most people just gonna go with Harry Greb because Stanley Ketchell didn't really get a chance to finish his career because he got shot in the back. So I don't know what, I'll just leave it up to you guys in the comment section to see who you think, and whoever you pick, hey, either way, it's a great fight. I'll catch you later. Peace. DJ Boxing Live here. DJ Boxing Live here.